church in Salandy. I was woken up this morning at 2:30 by the sound of my furnace. It was running well, and it was a sound that made me grateful because I've got heat in my house. And then I get up and use the restroom, and I'm like, there's running water in my house, and it's clean, and I can drink it. So many things that we just take for granted. Amen. And I think coming to this place may be one of those things that we take for granted. And I don't want us to. I just read an article last week that in China, people who are churchgoers are now having their fingerprints and faces scanned before they go into their places of worship. We don't have that here in the United States. So we need to grab a hold of the freedoms that we have, the joy that we have, and be grateful that we can gather together without fear to come and to worship and learn about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to encourage one another. So I encourage that you're here today. If you are a guest with us today, welcome. We want you to feel welcome. We would love to hear a little bit more about you so that we can let you hear a little bit more about us. You've got a connect card right in the pew back in front of you there. If you take that out and fill out as much information as you can and drop that in the offering plate as it comes by you, and feel no obligation to drop anything else in there. We want you to feel like you are truly welcome at our guest today. Some other things that are going on. We've got a bunch of praises. I went over and saw Sylvia Gibbs, and she had kind of an up and down week, and yesterday she was up. And she had a food tray that she was tearing into. And the nurse came in and she said, that's the wrong food tray. And I thought she was going to stick the nurse's hand with a fork. So that just made me laugh. Linda and I were just laughing. So please continue to pray for her. She's going to have about a 2-week stay. She's over at Superior Woods now, but wanted to be sure to update everybody with that because we'd asked for prayer for her last week. So she's doing quite well today. Another cool opportunity that we have coming up in the month of January, and I'll draw your attention to the bottom of the 167 light here. We have an opportunity to give donations towards the Church World Service. And they're providing help in the form of blankets. And I watched a documentary last night on the three girls that were held hostage in Cleveland for 10 to 12 years. And once they were rescued, the first thing that the EMS did was they put a blanket around them. There's just something about the security of that. And it may not mean anything to us because we have our furnaces on and we have running water that we can drink and we lose sight of that. But there are people around the world who are involved in different disasters and storms and whatever that organizations are sent to. And these blankets that we have an opportunity to partner with Church World Services about, they provide that immediately, that warmth and that security. So I would ask that you consider giving towards that for the month of January. I also wanted to just highlight, we had Allison Foreman from It's Winning Meals on Wheels last week. She did a phenomenal job of giving us an update on their organization. But we have a number of other organizations that we partner with. And we're going to be giving you more information in 167 Life about that. But we want to kind of put this out in front of you so that you can pray for these organizations. Our own Doug Campbell, who was here for a number of years, is over at Hope Clinic. And Hope Clinic is doing some amazing things in this community. So we're real pleased to be able to partner with them, and then the likes of some of the other ministries that we have listed for you down there today. Excited to be here today. Are you excited to be here today?
Yeah.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this privilege. And God, I pray that it would not be a privilege that would, Father, be calloused, one that we would just expect would happen week after week after week. But Father, every time that we drive past this place, we park our car in a parking lot, make our way into this building, Father, unfettered, without fear, God, that we would understand what a huge blessing that is. And God, that we would take advantage of that. And Father, that we would not become so comfortable with that, however, Lord, that we just kind of tune you out. And we tune things that maybe are set in this place that would make us feel uncomfortable because it takes us into a new realm of obedience. But Father, that we would do that as a response to what you have done for us. And Jesus, you loved us so much that you came to this earth and you lived a life and you gave your life. And God, I pray that that would not be forgotten on us. Father, that would not be taken for granted. So Lord, as we have the opportunity to lift you up and to worship you today, I pray that our minds would be engaged. I pray that we would be in this very moment right now. And Father, that we would pay attention to the words that we lift to you as our worship. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Ooh, in the bed.
like to invite the ushers forward for our time of giving.
Has thy word been a lamp unto our feet in the past, it will be this morning as well. Man, I'm falling apart up here. So I was at a restaurant with my wife last night having some dinner, and when we walked in, it was a familiar face greeted us and welcomed us and took us to our table, and Trina said, "Did you hear that?" And I said, "No." She said, she was introducing you as her pastor to all of her coworkers. And I was like, that is really cool. I love having that title, pastor. Not for any type of, you know, ungodly thing, but I just love what I do. And I love the opportunity to be able to do that here and to be with you guys. So thank you for the opportunity that is extended to me to be able to do that. Talking about opportunities, how many people were able to stay up and watch the new decade ring in? Whoa, lots. Lots of people. I remember when I was younger, and that was a really big deal. Now that I'm not so young, I was like, oh, the date changed on my watch. You know, that type of thing. So I happened to be installing a dishwasher for my daughter and her husband the other day, and I needed some help. So Trina got down, and so we're both down on the ground, and I'm trying to lift the dishwasher up, and she's screwing the leveling legs down, and I'm trying not to get frustrated with her, because she's not doing it exactly the way that I wanted it to be done. I mean, it was getting done, but not the way that I would have done it. So I'm not saying anything, and she's like, "What's wrong?" I don't know why people ask those questions of me if they don't want to hear what I have to say. So I was like, "Nothing." And she goes, and then she says, "Well, what am I doing wrong?" So I don't know how she got that through nothing. Well, I do know how she got that through nothing.
Years of being with me.
So we got the dishwasher installed, and we're still married, and we still love each other. And I asked Josiah to go downstairs and to get something. So he got that, and he got something else too. I'm not sure how he got like photo album confused with drill, but he brought up this photo album. And in this photo album, Trina had saved like everything from like fifth grade on. So, and when I say everything, I mean, so you guys know that we've known each other since first grade. And we did whatever, boyfriend and girl, like we went together. Our daughter was completely laughing. In fifth grade and then sixth grade and then just regular. So she saved every note that I ever wrote her. And she's got it posted in this little photo album. So the first thing my daughter says is, Dad's handwriting is exactly the same. So I don't know how to take that. I'm going to take that as a plus because it was at least legible. And then Mom says, yeah, look at his signature. My signature is exactly the same too. So I guess there's something for being said about, you know, not changing. So we're reading through all of this stuff and Trina says, she says, wow, she goes, this is the teaching her. She goes, your punctuation was deplorable. I said, hon, I was in fifth grade. Give me a break. So notwithstanding her correcting my punctuation, it was fun to kind of go back down that memory lane. But then to realize as we're standing there with our daughter who has a daughter and our other children that the decades continue to march forward. So Trina, she has a group of friends that are all working on their doctorate together because they're crazy. And they're all about the same age. So one of them said, hey, this year is the sixth decade that we've been alive and we're not 50. So they thought that was pretty cool. My brain hurt just a little bit trying to figure that out, but I was like, whatever floats your boat, whatever makes you guys happy. But at the end of the day, when Trina and I were trying to get up off the floor, you know, holding the dishwasher up, and she said to me, she goes, we're getting old. And I said, yeah, I said, but, you know, we still tolerate each other. And she goes, yeah, everything that I've put you through. And I was like, everything that you've put me through? I said, how about the daily stuff? And she pauses for a minute. And apparently my nonsense that I give to her on a daily basis kind of gives cancer a run for its money, you know, as far as just a hard time. But I do remember back in the day when we were much younger that it was a big deal to stay up past midnight. So I've worked midnights for the last 11 years. So like midnight is just like a coffee break. So like, it's no big deal for me. Although this year I did get to see a fireworks show on my watch. I did not know that. Does anybody else watch their watch? So Apple provides a free fireworks show on the Apple Watch at midnight on New Year's. It was kind of cool. I just happened to look down and my watch is exploding on my wrist. It was pretty cool. But after midnight, 2020 kind of comes in and you're like, oh, you either go to sleep, you know, you start to clean up after the party, you continue on with work, whatever. But it is inevitable, though, that we make plans. And it's inevitable that we make promises to ourselves, and maybe you make promises to other people at this time of year. And a lot of times these are called what?
Resolutions.
These are called making resolutions. So some of these resolutions may include stuff like, this is the year. This is the year that I'm going to lose the weight that I want to lose. This is the year that I want to get in shape, that I want to watch less TV, that I want to read more. I want to spend less time on social media, to spend more time with God, or maybe even to spend more time with my family. Speaking of spending time with families, I will spend some time with my grandson Elijah over Christmas break. And he's 3 and he's full of energy. Lots of energy. Right, Austin? Yeah. Austin had a hard time keeping up with him. And this guy is fast. I mean fast. So I'm transferring the car seat from one vehicle to another, and I utter these words to him, hoping in my heart of hearts that he would listen. Stay here. That didn't even last a second. So he darts out in the parking lot, and there were two things that immediately went through my mind as I tried to get him. First, I don't want him to get hurt. Okay, that was obviously paramount. But second, and this was almost as important and legitimate in my mind, I didn't want to get in trouble from his mom and dad. So like, I didn't want to be that granddad, you know, that loses the grandchild or he gets hurt or something like that. And then I would never, like, have access to him again. So this is all running through my mind as I reached him. And then one large step is he was laughing. So he taunts me. So he's running just out of arm's reach. He's just kind of going back and forth, just back and forth, back and forth. So I surprised him by how fast his fat grandpa can move. And I caught him. But when I have conversations with Elijah, I have to listen really, really close because he kind of has his own language. And he kind of speaks like, he speaks in terms that I don't necessarily understand, so I try to listen really close. But then he does speak very clearly a couple words. Grampy is one word that he speaks very clearly. And Grammy is another one. So whenever I hear Grampy or Grandma, I'm like, yeah, okay. You know, just trying to kind of keep the conversation going on. So when his mom is around and she kind of hears him babbling on like this, this is what she says. Elijah, use your words. Use your words. And 9 times out of 10, it's just that he's trying to speak too fast. And then when he kind of slows down and he can kind of speak in utterances that I can understand. So all of us are parents or grandparents, and you've got children or grandchildren that are maybe right around or a little bit older than 2 or 3. We know that phrase well, don't we? Use your words. Use your words. So when Josiah was a baby, he was way speech delayed. Like, he did not really begin to speak until he was almost 5. So he would babble, and my brothers thought that he spoke French. So my brother Kyle would actually speak French back to him. And I was like, you're an idiot. Why are you speaking French back to him? He doesn't know what you're saying. So we had taught Josiah some sign language. And he was really good about using it. Matter of fact, he still uses it today. Like, you know, when he says, say please or thank you or more, you know, those types of things. But when he began to use his words, we were really, really excited. So you know that when children are young and they're just learning to talk, sometimes they get frustrated or sometimes they get excited. And even though they're learning these new words, they kind of use grunts or groans or screams or whimpers, or they use hand motions, you know, I want that, to try and tell us something. And it's at these times that we use that classic parenting terminology. Use your words. Use your words. As parents or grandparents who love our children or grandchildren, we want to help move them into a direction where they can move out of immaturity and into maturity. And part of this journey, part of this process, is getting them, equipping them, enabling them to articulate what they're feeling or what they are thinking. And this then is to allow them to truly grow. To truly grow. Kids have to learn how to use their words in the communication process. Now, what's true in parenting is also true in evangelism. It's also true in evangelism. Perhaps one of your resolutions in 2020 was to share your faith more, to share the gospel. Maybe that wasn't on your radar at all, because the prospect of that scares the living daylights out of you. To take part in evangelism means that we're spreading God's word, that we're spreading God's message of salvation. And if we really want to mature in our own faith, if we really want to mature in our relationship with Jesus Christ, we have to mature in our outreach effectiveness. And in order to do that, we of course have to use our words. We have to use our words. A pastor friend of mine recently told a story of a pretty awkward conversation that he had with a woman in his church in Colorado. In their fellowship hall. I can't imagine an awkward conversation taking place in the fellowship hall, but Greg tells of this story, and he said that she told him that she never really articulated the gospel with her neighbors, but simply let them see Christ in her. She went on. She said that she had no intention and felt no obligation to try and share the gospel message with them verbally. Greg explained to her that evangelism requires words. As a matter of fact, in the Greek, the word evangelize comes from a word that simply means to verbally declare the good news. I mean, even if you look up evangelism in the dictionary, it literally says the spreading of the Christian gospel by public preaching or personal witness. Now, of course, we read through the book of James. We studied the book of James, right? We have to live out the message of the gospel. And yes, we want to build those loving relational bridges with those around us. But we must let our light shine through the way that we live. But without words, without us articulating what it is that we believe, we are not sharing the message that can save them from a hopeless life and a Christless eternity. If you have your Bibles this morning, I want to invite you to open up to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. New Testament, last half of the Bible. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and then Romans. Romans chapter 10, and we're going to go to verse 14. Romans chapter 10 and verse 14. Paul tells us here, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? You see, people need to hear the message of the gospel. They need to hear that message articulated, not simply to see it lived out, but they need to hear it. We need then to use our words. Over the years, of course, I've heard plenty of excuses why someone doesn't verbally declare the gospel to somebody. See if you've ever used these. They have a range of applications. Postmoderns don't respond to propositional assertions. How about this? How about, that's not my style? Or, if I really live it, then at some point they will ask me what I believe. This is my favorite. That's not my gift. I'll just bring them to church. But beyond all the excuses, beyond perhaps even other excuses past those, lurks the real reason for their gospel silence. And what is the real reason? I mean, if you boiled it all the way down, the real reason is fear and shame. That's the real reason. Maybe there's the fear of not knowing what to say. Hold on to that. Maybe it's the fear of rejection, of losing friends. Maybe that's what keeps them silent. As a result, they're not willing to pay the price of following Jesus by risking their relationships by simply bringing the gospel up. Down deep inside, there's this fear of rocking that relational boat by sharing this very exclusive message of Jesus to their inclusive peers. I mean, who wants to make people feel comfortable? I don't think we're necessarily wired naturally that way. We don't want to bring discomfort to our friends or our peers, because that may bring discomfort to us. It's like having a syringe full of the cure for cancer, which if you're a conspiracy theorist, you think is already out there. It's like having the syringe full of this cure for cancer, but refusing to use it on a friend with cancer because you're afraid of hurting them with a needle. Ooh, that's an interesting thought. There are way too many of us Christians that hide behind evangelistic philosophies that fall short of the New Testament norm. And what do I mean by that? I mean, because we're afraid of the friction, we're maybe afraid of the frustration, and we're maybe even afraid of the potential fallout of having a gospel conversation with one of our friends, maybe even a family member, or maybe even a peer at work. Jesus makes something pretty crystal clear to us that I just want to remind us about here this morning. Turn back over to the book of Mark. If you're in Romans, it's going to be over to the left. The book of Mark. Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8 and verse 38. We find here, for whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Ouch. Ouch. We don't want Jesus to be ashamed of us. That should motivate us not to be ashamed of Jesus Christ and not to be ashamed of his words, not to be ashamed of what he did by way of a selfless act for us. We didn't deserve it, but yet it was a manifestation of his love for us. Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel," he says. "For it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and then also to the Greek." Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of his words. Communicate these words. Communicate them with a humble heart. And here's the thing that many of us miss in this process. Communicate them with a listening ear. But also communicate them. Communicate them with your life, how you live, how you respond. But also communicate them with your words. So where should we be headed with all of this in 2020? How should our lives change? How should our approach to evangelism change? So if you're using your words to share the gospel, if that message, if that challenge completely freaks you out, don't worry. Stop asking the question, "I don't know what to say." Because we're going to equip you with some tools to be able to do this. And for those of you who are tech savvy, we even have some apps. Because you can't really do anything in 2020 without an app, right? We have some apps that will help you with that. However, one of the first things that all of us need to do is to get a little background reading under our belt. This can be found in the book of Acts. Has anybody ever read the book of Acts front to back? Wow. I mean, among other things, it just is a phenomenal piece of literature. You learn so much from this book. So much can be found in the book of Acts. It's here in the book of Acts where we find the blueprint that is given to the church on one specific task. You know what that task is? How to spread the gospel message. It's amazing. And Jesus begins the entire book with giving us a blueprint. Turn over to the book of Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. We've referenced this before, Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. This is the roadmap. This is the how-to. This is evangelism 101. Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. And Jesus says this, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you." And he says, "You will be my witnesses." Where? "You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And then what follows in this entire book is exactly that taking place. So just prior to this book, we have four versions of the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. We have four perspectives. And of course, each one of those perspectives comes by way of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Four gospels, right? Each one gives us a perspective on Jesus and his life and his ministry. But you know what? We are only giving one. We only have one account of the birth and the growth of the early church. That alone makes Acts a worthwhile read for us. It also makes it our one story of the spread of Christianity across the New Testament world. It makes it unique and it makes it indispensable. Traditionally, this is the book that bridges the gap between the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then the rest of the New Testament letters, and it's sometimes known as the Acts of the Apostles. So, since Luke wrote this, the author, he focuses on Peter and Paul, and then lesser known characters like Philip and Stephen. And he focuses much more on them than the original 12 apostles or the original 12 disciples. So if you're kind of into precision, a little bit more precise title might be "The Continued Acts of Jesus by His Spirit to the Apostles and Other Christian Leaders." That's way too long. That's way too long. So you can boil it down by simply saying Acts. And that's what we know it is by. So as you read through the book of Acts, you'll see how it shows and how it tells us how God worked through the early church, not just for work's sake, but the result was the world changed. The world changed with this message that is going out. It can still serve as an incredible instructional guide for us today in 2020. Unless, of course, you guys are of the opinion that the world doesn't need to change. I'm going to take that as a no. A current presidential candidate recently said of the West Virginia coal miners that an option for them and their industry, if their industry were to drastically change, would be to learn computer coding. Well, that may be true, but for many in that industry, it's all that they've ever known. The sentiment rings true for us in our discussion this morning, too. Perhaps relying on someone else to share the gospel message has been all that we've ever known. Perhaps simply bringing someone to church to have them hopefully hear the gospel is all that we've ever known. No matter if this is the case or not, we have an obligation to articulate clearly and accurately what Jesus has done for us. It's because of what Jesus has done for us, what that cost him, the motivation for why he did that, and our accepting of this gift, that we have the privilege of accessing God. It is because of what Jesus has done for us that we have forgiveness of our sins. It is because of what Jesus has done for us that we have hope that he will once again return for us and that we will exist with him for all of eternity in the presence of God, with God as the role of our Heavenly Father, loving. Because Jesus died on the cross for our sins. Because he was put in a tomb and then he conquered death and he rose again. Because of that, we don't have to fear death if we have accepted that gift. We have the privilege to remember and be encouraged all of the time. But sometimes we need a prompt to remind us of that. And that prompt, of course, is the taking of the Lord's Supper or communion. If you have your Bible still open, turn over just to the next book, 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 to the right. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul gives some instructions here. He gives instructions to a church that he loved. I mean, he loved the church of Corinth, but he was so frustrated with them because they just didn't listen to him all the time. I mean, seriously, by a show of hands right now, if we'd have listened to an authority figure in our life and would have stayed out of trouble if we would have listened to him, how many people have ever been there done that? A few. And then there's a few of you who are like Jesus with skin on that I can't even see. We all have that opportunity, don't we, if we just would have listened. And Paul is giving them instructions here on how they are to participate in the Lord's Supper. But I love how he does it. He just seems to, this first part, do it quite tenderly. In verse 17 of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he says this, "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it's not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized." Verse 20. "When you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk." Verse 22, "What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this?" He says, "No, I won't. You guys, you didn't listen. You didn't listen." Verse 23, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'
For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Friends, we are able to participate in this remembrance. We're able to participate in this amazing communion, us coming together to remember this, because we have responded to the gospel message. We have responded to God's love. We have asked for forgiveness and repented of our sins. We've accepted that free gift. If you're here today and you've done that, but you're not a member of First Baptist, that's okay. This is an open table. You can still participate with us. You can still remember what Christ did. And you can have the assurance that he will keep his promise. This new covenant. One death for all sins. Not one death for one sin, which is what the old covenant was. And that he will once again return. It's inevitable. It's inevitable. We just don't know the time. But we know that it will for sure happen. That alone should give us hope. That alone should give us hope. So as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper this morning, I would ask that you take just a minute to reflect on this. That you would take just a few minutes to ask God, is there anything that is standing in the way of me enjoying a completely pure relationship with you? And if that's the case, would you take advantage of what Jesus paid for? And that is the forgiveness of sin. On that night when he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, which incidentally is why we can share the gospel message. Because he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Take and eat all of it." Father, we talked already this morning about not taking things for granted. And God, I pray that although our memory would be fresh about what Jesus did for us, Father, that we would not take that for granted. Father, that we would celebrate that as Him showing how much He loved us. Jesus, thank you for that sacrifice. Thank you for the pain that you endured. Thank you for the shame that you endured. So that Jesus, we might have forgiveness of our sins if we would but come to you. Father, thank you for the larger plan that you had in store. Thank you for giving your one and only Son so that we too may have access to you. We pray this in Christ's name. Same night, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Drink all of it." As often as we participate in this, friends, we declare that Jesus Christ will return again for us, those of us who are his children. 2020 is going to be an amazing year for all of us. As I spent time with my grandson Elijah, my mother-in-law has magnetic Etch-A-Sketch. And Elijah was coloring faces on it, and he would bring it to me, and he would show me his artwork. And then I would erase it just by pulling it down, and the first time I did it, he was like, wide-eyed. And then he would draw it again, and I would erase it again. And he was wide-eyed again. Friends, we are so early to 2020, we could be pulling that button and starting with a brand new screen. What will your story be of 2020? I pray that it includes being able to not only articulate, but having the desire to articulate the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me, Father? Thank you for this amazing opportunity that we have, the privilege that we have, Lord, to come together, Father, to encourage one another, Father, to pray for and to pray with one another. Father, I'm thankful for what we have the privilege of doing by way of participating in this, your table. God, I pray that we would understand what that cost, and Father, that we would continually, not just once a month, but continually, Father, would understand the ramifications of that. And Father, may we be thankful and grateful with every moment. We ask this in Christ's name.
When brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. Oh, I won't be shaken.
That is the root of everything that we should stand for as well. God loved us enough to send His Son to this earth to die for us. Friends, we need.